It gives me immense pleasure to welcome Kiran ji, the chairperson of Biocon. We are honored, privileged, and grateful to have her with us. Kiran ji, you have been recognized world over for your immense contribution to the biotech sector. Your rise as a business leader has indeed been inspiring for a generation of budding entrepreneurs, and especially women entrepreneurs, as you were able to build a sustainable business in a completely new high-tech area. We remember in the late 70s and 80s, biotechnology was still very nascent science, and financial institutions were hesitant to offer credit to the enterprises in this area. It was all the more difficult for a businesswoman to break the glass ceiling and secure acceptability among male colleagues and subordinates. Overcoming all these obstacles and building a world-class biotech company is indeed a credible achievement. No wonder then that you have been regularly featured in the list of most influential women and business leaders in the world and received numerous awards and accolades. India has witnessed tremendous growth in the area of biotechnology, and the industry was pegged at about 11.6 billion in 16-17. The sector is expected to grow at a fast clip and reach about $100 billion in terms of revenue by 2025. There is tremendous scope in the various subsectors of this industry, including biopharma, bioagri, bioinformatics, bioservices like clinical trials and contract research, etc. However, the hard fact remains that India's share in the global biotechnology industry is barely 2%. We therefore need a significant push by all the stakeholders to trigger exponential growth and garner substantial share in the global biotechnology market. We would be keen to understand your assessment of the bioeconomy of India and its prospects going forward. You may also like to reflect on what it would take India to emerge as a leading player in the biotechnology industry in the future. Without further ado, may I now invite you to share your thoughts with us.
Thank you, Sandeep, Sangeeta, Mr. Kamath, Dilip, and members of the National Committee of FICCI. First and foremost, thank you for giving me this opportunity of speaking to you on a subject which I think is extremely relevant and important as we look towards fostering robust economic growth for our country. I, for one, have very strongly believed that we as an agrarian economy have to basically unleash the potential of biotechnology in building what we now refer to as a bioeconomy. Now, what do we mean as a bioeconomy? Bioeconomy is the phrase or the reference given to the leveraging of bioresources using biotechnology to value add in terms of economic productivity. And here, I would say that the bioeconomy is a very, very crucial and important segment of our economy because it basically straddles a number of very, very key attributes that any economic growth engine requires of our nation. One is, of course, food security. The other is health security, and the other is environmental security. And, you know, the good news is that biotechnology and the bioeconomy actually addresses all three pillars of this economic sustainability through very, very potent and very effective means. So let me talk about India's bioeconomy. As we speak, today India's bioeconomy has been sized at about $50 billion. And we aim to make it $100 billion by 2025 and $200 billion in the next 5 years, which is by 2030. And let me explain what I mean by this. If you look at India's bioeconomy today, a large part of this bioeconomy today is actually contributed by the biopharma segment of the bioeconomy. And what is very important for me to mention here is that over the years, over the decades, India's ability to harness its life science capabilities and its engineering capabilities in bioengineering have actually enabled us to become the world's largest producer of vaccines. This is such an important success factor for India's bioeconomy that I would also like to mention here that today, 1 in 2 children in the world are vaccinated using Made in India vaccines. So this is a Made in India story that we are not talking about enough. I really believe that India's pharma sector and India's biopharma sector are a very, very important flagship of India's Make in India policy. India makes for the world some of the best and most cost-effective products in the world that provide affordable access to patients across the world. Generics and vaccines have been the mainstay of India's pharmaceutical prowess. And in biotechnology, vaccines have certainly become a symbol of India's success as a biotech nation. Now, adding to this is now going to be biopharmaceuticals. And many of us have actually led the way in basically emulating the success of generics by bringing to the world what we call as biosimilar products. Biosimilars are basically replicate models of biologic drugs, which today are becoming extremely, extremely important in addressing many of the unmet needs in medical, in medicine, including cancer, diabetes, autoimmune disease, and many, many other types of diseases. And these drugs are beyond the reach of most people in most parts of the world. Today, thanks to companies like ours and many others in the country, we have actually provided affordable access to life-saving drugs for cancer patients, for diabetics. If you remember, insulin was a product that was imported 100% only about 2 decades ago. And we also relied a lot on animal insulin because recombinant human insulin is something people could not afford. We brought to the market recombinant human insulin at a price point that today has brought down the price of insulins across many developing world markets to a tenth of what they used to be. And this is what biosimilars can do for patients across the world. The biosimilar market is estimated to be $100 billion over the next 10 years. And we believe that Indian companies have a very, very big opportunity to grab a big piece of this pie. The next big sector in the bioeconomy, as is obvious, is agribiotech. Agribiotech, of course, goes beyond the conventional agricultural technologies. It actually harnesses gene technologies and many other growth indicators in agriculture to bring about productivity, to basically address drought and other aspects of soil cultivability, etc., etc. And what we are seeing is that agricultural biotechnology is actually beginning to become an extremely important part of our agricultural future. Today, India again is, you will be interested to know, the largest producer and exporter of GM cotton. India, as you remember, used to be a net importer of cotton. Today, we are a net exporter of cotton. We do not even have to import any more cotton. This is how powerful this technology has become for a country like India. And I think GM cotton is another big success story for India's biotech sector. The third and most important aspect of biotechnology which I must mention is the area of industrial biotechnology. Industrial biotechnology is very, very crucial for India's future. This is a technology segment of biotechnology that basically leverages enzyme technologies to replace a number of polluting chemical technologies. Additionally, it is also a sector which is looking at renewable energy using bio-waste and biomass, using enzyme technologies to convert it into renewable energy, like bioethanol and biofuels. So I think this is something that we must bear in mind as an important part of our bioeconomy as we move forward. At the moment, as I mentioned, this is a $50 billion bioeconomy that encompasses the biopharma, the agri-biotech, and industrial biotech segments. But over the next few years, by 2025, in 5 years' time, this bioeconomy is going to double. Why? Because we believe that there are other aspects of biotechnology which have a huge potential to transform what we are doing today. One of this, of course, is this whole area of gene technology and bio-IT. Bio-IT is going to be a very important confluence of information technology and biotechnology, because this is now going to make a big difference to the way we deliver healthcare, the way we mine data, the way we use data to basically script healthcare policies and other kinds of policies that will actually help us to have a much stronger economic understanding of what it takes to actually develop a strong growth engine. We have talked about the exponential growth of the bioeconomy, and let me explain how we propose to do this. We expect the biopharma sector to be a $35 billion opportunity by 2030, of which vaccines will contribute $10 billion, biosimilars and biopharmaceuticals will contribute $15 billion, and as I mentioned earlier, gene testing or genetic testing is going to also contribute another $10 billion. Genomic-based diagnostics and gene testing is going to be a very, very important part of the future of healthcare and health diagnostics. And this is going to be a great opportunity for India and Indian companies to basically leverage this very, very important technology. Today, you can actually basically sequence an entire human genome for less than $100, which used to take more than, you know, $3 million at one stage. So this is how the cost of gene sequencing has come down. And now that the cost of gene sequencing has come down, I think you can use gene sequencing very effectively for a number of aspects. Of course, as I mentioned, one is, of course, this whole area of diagnostics, where, you know, looking at various genetic factors, you can actually diagnose today the kind of cancer and personalize the kind of cancer treatment that can effectively deal with that particular cancer gene that has mutated. Other than that, there are many other genetic diseases which also need to be diagnosed, understood, and treated. And today, with biotechnology, you can do all of this. Today, we have some amazing technologies in terms of stem cell technologies, in terms of personalized medicine using engineered T cells and what have you. And these are the kind of technologies we are now trying to bring to India through various kinds of partnerships. So I think it's a very, very exciting time. So as you can see, this is going to be a very, very important segment of the bioeconomy by 2030. Now coming to bio-IT, we believe that this is a $25 billion opportunity for the bioeconomy. This will involve data storage, data mining, sequencing, and big data analysis. Everyone talks of big data. We believe that the pharma and health science area has the biggest amount of data that is not being analyzed and tapped the way it should be. So this is an opportunity for India, because today data is extremely valuable, and this is data that India needs to leverage, India needs to mine, and India needs to basically convert into new knowledge and new products and new diagnostics. This is what we believe will be a huge, huge opportunity for Indian companies, and it is beginning to happen. There are a number of Indian companies which have already started their business models based on gene sequencing. And I'm pleased that at last there are some very, very important signals that are coming through that these companies are going to become very, very successful in the near future. Coming to bioagri, biofuels and enzyme technologies, this is another $40 billion opportunity. And this $40 billion opportunity is split between agri-bio, which will become a $25 billion opportunity. This is at the moment a $10 billion opportunity, but we expect this to become a $25 billion opportunity by 2030, because we believe that many, many crops are going to utilize gene technologies, basically to produce hybrid varieties that can actually address a number of the unfavorable cultivation conditions that they currently face. Biofuels along with enzymes are considered to be a $15 billion opportunity. It all depends. I believe this can be a much bigger opportunity depending on how the balance between fossil and non-fossil fuel goes, and of course how the balance between solar energy and other forms of renewable energy go. But this again is a very big opportunity. For example, today we are facing this huge pollution crisis in Delhi, which is being caused by burning stubble after the harvest is over. That stubble can be converted into biofuel. And I think that is something which we ought to really look at as a country. We should not be burning anything for that matter. Agricultural waste is a huge, huge substrate for many, many agricultural products, especially biofuels. As far as leveraging big data is concerned, you know, we are over a billion people. We have 4,500 anthropologically well-defined populations. 11% of the total known flora exists in India. 15 agroclimatic zones exist in India. There are 47,000 different plant species, 15,000 species of medicinal plants, and 1,500 medicinal plants identified by Indian systems of medicine or Ayurveda. I think all this can be mined very effectively using big data analytics. And I think this is time for us to really start building IP around this kind of data. We are really not done justice to this very, very useful, rich and powerful data that we have. And I can tell you that many countries in the world are generating huge value out of much smaller amounts of data that they possess. So I really believe that this is time for us to really look at how we leverage this data intelligently and create value from such data. So when we look at what is it that we need to do to really create this huge bioeconomy for the country, first and foremost, I believe that we are underinvested in science and technology. Today, the country invests less than 1%. In fact, we are at 0.8% of our GDP when it comes to research and science and technology. We keep talking about innovation. We keep talking about translational research. We keep talking about applied research. If we do not invest in basic research, there will be nothing to translate and nothing to apply. We need to invest in basic research. We need to invest in applied research. We need to invest in translational research. Most countries and in the world are investing furiously in science, technology, and research because they realize that that is the future that will set them apart from other countries. Most countries do not have the kind of scientific talent pool that we have. Most countries do not have the kind of engineering talent pool that we have. We have a powerful combination of scientists and engineers. And if we do not leverage that capability and that talent pool that we have, we are doing a huge injustice to ourselves. We have to basically catch up with many others who are making science and technology their differentiating competitive advantage. And we need to make sure that we actually see this as a very strong competitive advantage. We keep talking about reversing the brain drain, but you cannot reverse the brain drain without investing in the fundamentals of that brain creation. And I, for one, believe that when you look at countries like Korea, who are investing 3 to 4% of their GDP on R&D and science and technology, when you look at even countries like China, which are increasing it to almost 3%, and when you look at, of course, countries like Israel and others who are much smaller than us, no doubt, who are actually investing 4 to 5% of their GDP in science, technology, and research, and we are at an abysmal 0.8. We are actually the lowest in the BRICS economy. Brazil invests 2.5%. Okay? Russia is upwards of 2%. We are the only ones below 1%. So I believe that we must at least invest 2% of our GDP on science, technology, and innovation. And I think this is something which we also need to focus on in a big way. I think leadership is going to be very important. I think Rajiv before me also spoke on the same thing. We have great research institutes that we have created, but I think we lack the scientific leadership to do justice to those institutions. And I really believe that a combination of scientific leadership along with greater investment in science, technology, and research will actually pave the way for a very, very strong competitive path forward when it comes to differentiation and when it comes to economic sustainability. Without investing in science and technology, there will be no great innovation that can sustain itself. Even the IT sector needs that investment in basic research. Today, the services model is changing. We are actually looking at innovating for the world. It is about high science, high mathematics, high technology. It is about artificial intelligence and analytics that calls for deeper investment in basic sciences. And I think this is what is going to be extremely important as we go forward. So I really believe that the next government has to invest very, very deeply in science and technology and research and focus on building scientific thought leadership at the research institutions if we are to do justice to what we are capable of doing. We have already shown that ISRO, with very frugal resources, has done wonders. But it has good leadership. It has good scientific leadership. That's what has made it possible. I think India, if it actually invests 2% of its GDP in science and technology, I think we can do wonders, because we can get far more for far less. And I think that is the model we have to pursue. It is about affordable innovation. It is about making sure that investing and getting the maximum out of these kind of investments will give us a clear global competitive advantage when it comes to innovation. That's our future. We need fiscal enablers because science, technology, research, and innovation is a gestational process. It doesn't happen overnight. We cannot have a stop and start approach to science and technology and investment. We must endure, we must continue to invest, and we must also recognize the fact that investing in science and technology has a gestational payback. But when the payback happens, it's big time. That's what the US has recognized, that's what we need to recognize. We need to have very strong industry-academia partnerships. And there is this constant conundrum of, you know, the fact that industry feels that academia does not have the kind of excellence that they need. And yet, excellence will not happen without these partnerships. So I believe that industry and academia must start forging excellence, must start forging partnerships that will build the excellence to take us to where we need to be. And of course, I think research and innovation is about creating intellectual property. And therefore, the patenting culture also must be highly encouraged whilst we build this capability. We need to make sure that we focus on some of our strengths which we today enjoy in global markets. We have this mantra of affordable innovation. And when we talk about mantra of affordable innovation, it means that the cost of our research activities is very competitive when we compare it to any other part of the developing or developed world. We are certainly extremely competitive when it comes to a number of these areas, especially when it comes to basically intellectual brain power. That is not about money. That's about your intellectual wisdom. That's about your ability to think. That's about your analytical skills. And I think India has a huge surplus of these kind of capabilities and thinking abilities. Critical thinking is going to be extremely important. And I again believe that the educational institutes that we are now going to create have to, you know, make sure that they actually involve and encompass that kind of critical thinking and design thinking and the whole focus on innovation and you know, this whole creative learning process that we need to adopt rather than the conventional educational processes of today. And I think there are many, many institutes that are being established to do that. I think with the advent of you know, the computer age, the ability for young children to actually educate themselves using a device, I think is actually opening our minds to many, many other things that are possible. So I really believe that educationalists and the education policy has to embrace this critical thinking that we need to embrace this research culture, this innovation culture, which will actually be able to make us in, and transform this country. So I would basically like to also comment on another aspect of the bioeconomy and you know, this whole aspect of science and innovation, which is really about focusing on cost competitiveness. I think India is very cost competitive, and that can be a huge huge competitive advantage if we can actually come out with, you know, world-beating innovation at that kind of a cost base. We are also a country that we know innovates for the world, because most others are innovating for small parts of the world that can afford their innovation. You know, recently I was just reading some of the an MIT report on the best and worst innovations of the 21st century thus far, and it was very interesting to know that the Segway was considered to be one of the worst inventions of this century, because they said it is just a very, very expensive motorcycle, a bike. So I just think these are the kind of things we need to look at. Yes, they also feel that the Google Glasses was a very, very poor innovation, because it was a very expensive device which really didn't serve any purpose. I think India as a country is very concerned about the kind of innovation that will make a huge difference to large numbers. That's a competitive edge. Okay, we also make sure that that innovation is accessible to large numbers. So cost becomes important. So whatever we do in pharma is a very good example of that kind of innovation. where I think access and affordable access is today becoming a mantra the world over. Healthcare costs are spiraling, drug prices are spiraling, and I can tell you that in every part of the world, they are challenged with cost of medicines. And they clearly recognize that India is a country that can actually offer very powerful and affordable solutions for what the whole world needs. As I always say, we as an industry should look upon ourselves as a humanitarian industry. We make products for patients. We make, you know, medicines for patients. And I think that is really what it's all about. So I believe that the bioeconomy is something that we need to focus on. The bioeconomy for a country like India is something that we have to only expand, because this touches every sector that is important for our economic growth: healthcare, agriculture, and environmental sustainability. So I would like to end there and say, I do hope that the next government will actually look upon the bioeconomy as a very important future for our economic development. And before I end, I'd just like to also make a reference to a very important part of policy which we need to change. We have something called the Biodiversity Bill, which actually is a very draconian bill when it comes to the biotech sector. I think we have gone endlessly to the government saying they need to change this bill, because I don't think the people who have scripted the act have really understood the damage it is doing to entrepreneurs, rather than the good it can do to society. The good intention of the Biodiversity Bill was to protect our natural bioresources. But they've gone beyond the brief of natural bioresources, and they have actually encapsulated everything that can be defined as a bioresource, whether it is man-made or not. And this is where the problem is. And many entrepreneurs today are really, really suffering because of the Biodiversity Bill. And I would like the FICCI to take up this Biodiversity Bill as something that needs to be changed, so that the industry and the entrepreneurs can grow at a prolific rate, which today they are being stunted by. Thank you.
Thank you, Kiranji. I can say on my behalf, and I think on behalf of all my friends and colleagues here, that definitely we are a lot more educated now than when we came into this meeting. The sheer size of the opportunity and its importance to the growth not only of India but the whole world, I think you have made it very, very clear. Thank you for your excellent presentation. Let me take, we have a few minutes for questions. So let me take the advantage of sitting on the head table and asking you, you gave us the example of BT cotton, where India has been very successful. From my very limited knowledge, I know that the government of India does not encourage the genetic engineering in food products like corn or wheat. What is the fundamental reason for that? Because that will also make us more competitive and we can export large quantities.
Well, I think this is a debate that has been, you know, taken away from science. And it is something that has become a very sensitive subject, because I think people who don't understand science can start believing that, there is this whole concept of Frankenstein science. And I think that's where it all emanates from. And they believe that, it could cause a lot of harm. And I don't think there is any merit to that, because if you have a scientific discussion, you can have a reasonable, rational discussion. But the moment you take it away from science, it's very difficult to have a reasonable debate and understanding on the subject. So for the time being, I think the government has decided that it's too sensitive a subject. There are many environmentalists who feel that tampering with genes is in terms of crops that are edible are likely to pose danger to health, which of course there's no evidence to suggest that. In fact, there's a large amount of genetically modified soya in our diet and diets around the world, but it's very difficult to argue that point. So I think for the time being, the government is being very careful because, you know, these are very highly sensitive issues. So I think even the sector itself has decided that instead of getting into genetic engineering, it's better to look at, gene amplification of the same varieties. So it's basically saying that you look for, it's like hybrids, it's like accelerating hybrid production. So what is hybrid production? Hybrids are that you take certain varieties which are highly productive in certain traits, and then you basically cross them and make sure that the dominant genes get replicated. Here, using gene technologies, using their same endemic genes, they basically amplify the genes so that you get the same levels of productivity and enhanced productivity. So I think these are some of the technologies today that are being adopted that are about gene enhancing rather than genetic engineering. And I think that itself can actually do wonders to agriculture and crops.
Thank you. As far as the biodiversity bill goes, I think we'll be in touch with your office and we will get your inputs.
Yeah, I think we should work with ABLE. Yeah. ABLE is the organization that's doing a lot of work, and I think they'd love to work with
Absolutely. You. Mr. Harshpati Singhania.
Kiran, thanks for that wonderful talk. Always a delight to hear you. 2 points. One, of course, I don't want to harp on what the president took up in terms of GM cotton, but I just do wish to point out, while we are the largest producers now and as a country, the technology actually resides, as you know, with a foreign company, Monsanto. And they are the licensees to everybody. And I know this from experience because we have a hybrid seeds company. And we worked with national laboratories in India to develop for the first time an indigenous GM cotton, which was thwarted for a variety of reasons. We'll not get into that. But the idea, the point being made, not to refute your point, but the point that we have the opportunity to develop, we need an ecosystem which joins all the dots is what you are saying. Which brings me to my point, in terms of, and you did talk about the R&D institutes, how do we further this whole issue of creating the ecosystem between institutes of development, starting, as you said, from the basic, basic research, to involving industry, and not just industry as in companies like yours who are in the business of doing this, but the user industries who would benefit from, let's say, chemical substitutes, some enzymes, and a whole lot of things. How do we bring this and the funders in place, like we have seen in the West? Could you amplify a little bit on that?
Yes, I completely agree with you that I think we have a large number of homegrown GM cotton technologies, and I know many companies have done that, and I think that needs to really be leveraged in a much bigger way. I agree with you. The second thing is, you'll be very interested to know that many of our agricultural science institutes, research institutes, have done some wonderful work. As you know, even PUSA Institute and many others have done excellent work. The UAS, even in Karnataka, in Bengaluru, has also done some amazing work. I think they have begun to forge relationships with small companies. But I think what we are finding is that these companies are actually, I mean, these universities are actually forging alliances with young entrepreneurs, with startup entrepreneurs. And many of the scientists within those institutes are also forming their own companies. So one good thing that has happened is that we have encouraged all the agricultural research institutes to start incubators so that they get their first connect to business. But I think it's for large businesses to really now start connecting with the research institutes. I think that is what is required. I think the way to connect the dots and the way to get the ecosystem going is really to ensure and mandate that every research institute actually spins off an incubator and allows its researchers to actually start or join startup companies. I think that's the way to start the ecosystem. And the funders, of course, you know, the government basically are good funders in terms of seed capital. What you really need to do is to go beyond the seed capital and to make sure that the VCs are willing to actually then take the risks over, which is still not happening in many cases. But I think agri is one area where you are likely to see good investment if the idea is good.
Kiran, as always, I think you're not just a treat to the ears, but a treat to the mind. You opened up so many dimensions. You have always been the poster child of female entrepreneurship. Today, you have become the beacon of a future economy. So I think everyone in the audience was amazed, was inspired by your entire insightful recital on the bioeconomy. I think all of us know so much about the pharma and what you've done in terms of vaccines, in terms of the fact that India does deliver healthcare at 1/10 of global prices, very much because of the pharma sector. The fact that agri was also well touched. I was particularly touched by the entire aspect on bio-IT and on industrial biotech. Today is World Earth Day. At the same time as we are growing our economies and growing our businesses, we are damaging and irreversibly damaging the planet. So I would urge, you know, all of us here to take up your insights into industrial biotechnology, into renewables, into recycling, into solar and everything you spoke about agri-waste. But I would, with the permission of Sandeep and the National Council, actually request that what we did in terms of security and what Rajiv spoke about many years ago and had a committee and a paper, may we request you, Kiran, to lead us in a bioeconomy paper that we collectively put forward, because I think there is so much new in the subject and so much potential for the country and for all of us. So if we can go in depth, create a committee, we then thank you for your presence and thank you in anticipation for what you're going to unfold for many of the businesses and for the contribution to the country. So it's with great pleasure that I request that we do this. We look at the biodiversity bill, and I think it's only appropriate that one of the most enlightened person in data is here today. So Nandan, welcome on behalf of all of us. And we would request you to look at the entire space of big data and its enablement of the bio sector. The Data Privacy Act, which has been referred to, is something that we really need to be, to not just be worried about, but I think to help craft appropriately so it is future friendly and helps us take this rightful place that India deserves in crafting the future economy through intelligence, intellectual capital, and innovation. So thank you, Kiran, and thank you, all of you. I think we should thank the audience as well. You had a spellbound audience. And thank the FICCI team for their tremendous work. Thank you all so much.